Chairman of Unique Identification Authority of India, Advisor to the State Government of Andhra Pradesh, Chairman of National Enterprise Architecture Working Group of Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. Mr. J.Satyanarayana is an IS officer of 1977 batch of Andhra Pradesh Cadre. Over to you, Mr. Satyanarayana.
Thank you.
Good morning, friends. Then James asked the audience, you know, how many of you are certified to have professionals? I do not stand up. So I am not a certified program person, but you know, trying to apply it with the help of professionals who are certified. So one of the quotes there was about you know, trying to explain what is EA, enterprise architecture. It's not about better architecture, but it's about a better enterprise. So from the perspective of government, which is really, you know, not only concerned with its own internal processes and its own services that it provides to the citizens, but also with the welfare of the society and you know, the development of the society. So what we are talking about here is a enterprise of enterprises, because it's so large and complex organization. How do you grapple with it? On the one hand, enterprise architecture, certainly let me mention my own experience with it, that it's a very, to have document itself is a pretty exhaustive one and possibly complex. Government is also a complex thing, or more complex thing. So when you put these two things together, it becomes complexity squared, right? So how do you manage this situation? So the basic thing, key theme that I want to tell all of you is about that, the fact that the enterprise architecture is about better enterprise. The focus is on the enterprise, what it does, how it does what it does. So key thing here is about transformation. How do you transform the department or the group of departments or the whole of government if you can. So key thing is about transformation. How do you use transformation, the key thing, how do you use enterprise architecture as one of the, you know, frameworks. That's going to be the theme of my presentation and illustrated with our own experience in the last 2 years. So, as I said, you know, the focus is on transformation, focus is on business of governance. So, what comes to our mind is the vision. What is the vision? Business vision of the state or a central government. And in that context, how e-planning concept has been started and how it proceeded. And also, we are going on to real-time governance situation. So I would like to spend the next half hour on that and just these themes. And tell you some practical, the lessons that we have learned the hard way in the last 2 years, which may be useful to you. Excuse me. So this is the United Nations Charter of Sustainable Development Goals. So it doesn't start with IT, as he said rightly. It's not just about IT, it's not only about IT. On the other hand, I go one step further and say, you should not start with IT. Enterprise architecture should not and does not start with IT. It starts with the vision on the business side. So, at the global level, you know, this is what United Nations has given, those 17 goals which need to be achieved by 2030. and it is further divided into 169 targets under these 17 goals. So how do you achieve? There are good things to achieve for governments. How do you do that with the person? And in what way IT can help, and in what way enterprise architecture can help IT and help government? So if you see, I will not speak much about the vision, because you know, the paucity of time and the context is about enterprise architecture. But I start with the business vision and then go on to enterprise architecture. We have got a new state called Andhra Pradesh, just divided from a larger state into a smaller state now, two states. So the new state, which was formed in the year 2014, a vision was developed, a 15-year vision was developed, which has a number of good goals on the development side. So the synopsis of that is that we created 7 development missions. 5 grids, like power grid, water grid, fiber grid, gas grid, and road grid. And fiber grid actually nearing completion any time. In fact, a good part of the state is also covered, and likewise there is progress on the other grids also. And 5 campaigns. And a vision document which doesn't speak much about IT. It's not about IT again. It's a huge document, 300 or 400-page document. Talks about, you know, what kind of development agenda should be there. Should be, you know, how do you develop your infrastructure? How do you develop the education? How do you develop the healthcare sector? How do you develop the tourism? And so many other, you know, growth engines of the state. So this is the agenda. Given that, you know, what is the role of IT in this? So these 7 missions again are about, you know, various sectors of the economy. There is nothing IT so far in what I have mentioned. That's what I am trying to emphasize. The primary sector, agriculture and allied, and the social sector means healthcare and education and so on. Skill development and employment, urban development, industrial development, infrastructure development, and the service sector. So these 7 sectors, number of goals have been set there, which again also overlap with the sustainable development goals that I have shown. In the context of Andhra Pradesh, in the context of what resources it has and what needs it has, what strengths it has, is all distilled into this vision document. And there is nothing IT about it as yet. So when you talk of this, there are a lot of, when you talk of IT, yes, what can IT do in this vision, achieving this vision? So this is what it can do. It can create a mission approach, it can support the mission approach, it can create a, you know, outcome, focus, measurability can bring, integrated approach through reuse of various artifacts, various things done in different sectors. There's a commonality about it, and how do you, you know, find the least common denominator and then make it common across the world government. Then how do you involve the citizens, end of the day, so that they feel they're part of the development process. And how we use visualization so that, you know, what you're doing is also more visually explainable. So all this is, you know, and there are lots of other things where IT can help with the vision. Okay, you're not starting with IT, but you're starting with the vision. Then you're trying to think about what role can IT play in achieving that development mission, welfare mission of the state. So in 2014, we said, you know, what can we do? Chief Minister of the state is a very well-known visionary in this area. He said, we sat together and then he said, what can we do? I said that we need to think big on this side, to have to adopt the enterprise architecture as a only way. Otherwise, 20 different departments going off in 20 different directions is not a good thing for the state. So that's how the concept of enterprise architecture came, and we started on this idea called e-Pragati, and it is a digest of the PAGAF, basically borrowed from PAGAF. A lot of the ideas e-Pragati have been borrowed from PAGAF as such. So it's a huge digital dream, I'll say, roadmap for public sector transformation. And then it's enterprise architecture applied to government using PAGAF, and also a platform for integration. I will illustrate them as I go forward.
you know, how these things are, the dream is, I mean, coming to stage by stage now. So why do you need e-Pragati? And this single slide actually I showed to the political executive, and I showed the whole complex thing, 622 pages or whatever of program document, in one word or one slide. You know, I said that, you know, if you go, you can go piece by piece like we have been doing for ages, or you can create a vision first. Imagine Taj, you have not built Taj, you imagine run it on a piece of paper, and then you build pillar by pillar, you get the Taj end of the day. If you do piece by piece, you don't know, you end up like any other building, you won't be Taj. So with this single slide, the sales talk was over, right, in 2 minutes. Then he became such a big fan, and the whole of government has been talking about e-Pragati, and you know. And very soon it was approved in the, by the cabinet in the year 2015, September. So, and this is the vision that we have drawn, that it supports, it enables the Sunrise AP, the Vision 2029. So we developed a huge, we made a huge effort with the help of IPRO, team of Palak Sahar and his team are here, team members. So we really worked very hard with several, almost 100 plus departments in the state government to understand their needs, their business needs, and trying to find out a common denominator and then create common systems for all of that. So I would request my colleague Srikanth to just bring the document just to get a visual idea of you know how we have done about it and how heavy it is. I just think if I carry this in my hand into the so this is a very heavy and big document. I would request you can just open up and show. So it has, you know, what those pictures and diagrams, bridges, buildings, all those in relation to government, they're all drawn in this, for all the 7 missions plus other common artifacts are all detailed in this document. So those who are interested also can access it on our website or need for this physical document. So this is how we started the whole thing. Develop your business vision first. This is more about business than about IT in this term. So I just wanted to give an idea of what, how we went about the whole e-Pragati. There is no TOGAF word mentioned deeply or frequently in this document, but TOGAF is behind the whole thing. It is digested while we were designing this document. Okay? So, this is, I thank Srikanth for taking the trouble to bring it here and explain it. Yeah. So, this is the vision document, and then it is about citizen-centric services, one government platform. We are trying to see that government is 100 departments today, but government can be one government, irrespective of, you know, which department, which agency is giving that service. And as I said, support Sunrise AP for larger vision for 2029 is supported through the various artifacts and various, you know, applications developed under e-Pragati. Now, this is also one more thing we superimpose on this, that you can slice and dice these services in the manner you like. Like, you know, life event based triggers. You have 700 plus services, you can slice and dice them according to. It's so very easy today, the kind of technologies that are available, and so very convenient to the citizen. So then what should I do when there is, you know, when I get married? What do I do when there is a childbirth, registration of birth, and you know, enrollment for Aadhaar? So many other things happen, enrollment in the, you know, child care segment and so on. So likewise, different life events have set of services associated all at one place. It becomes very, very intuitively necessary and quite possible. So the fact sheet is that we have 745 services identified in this book, and in 315 agencies of the government and 33 departments.
broken down into 72 projects, aggregated into 14 packages and created in 4 waves. And this is a 2 years execution period. So technically September 2017 we should have completed, but I'm a little bit, I was worried that, you know, it was going behind schedule by almost 1 year, I'd say. So, but now, for the last few months, it has picked up great traction. And our chief minister said, in fact, he declared that 2017 will be the year of e-Pragati for Andhra Pradesh. Officially, we are going to declare. It's also about the kind of political message that has go down, that has to go down to the various ministries, various departments, various functionaries. You know, down the line, the right message should go. So we're going to officially declare, we have declared orally, but the notification will have to be issued shortly on this. That the entire government, part of its time, it will be put behind e-Pragati, only it's possible. It cannot be done in a, you know, right-handed manner. So this size of that is, I think it's going to pick up great pace in this year 2017. Now this is also a busy slide, but it can't be read also from anywhere. But let me tell that this is, those are the 7 missions, and then on the left side are the various kinds of stakeholders, like the farmers and the, each one the black buttons on the left. I'll read for you, that's, you know, citizen, a woman, a child, a student, a farmer, a physically challenged person, a senior citizen, etc., etc. on the left side. And what are their needs? And how do you meet those needs? A business person, a person who is developing infrastructure, all those you know, stakeholders are there on the left, and what do they need? That is catered to by the architecture. And this is the 72 pieces of block that I mentioned, small blocks there. Each is a project, and each red you know, title there is about one package. So we have made them into 14 packages and 72 projects, as I said. And in the middle is the core. What we are calling the core is in the middle, and that's how we are. It is, though it's a very complex animal to handle, to make them doable by compartmentalizing the whole thing, but not losing the big picture at the same time. The underlying commonness of all those blocks, though they are for practical implementation purposes, they are, you know, physically separate, but logically there is underlying integrating fabric, especially through the core. So let me talk about the core. What is this thing in the middle, the block under the core there, in the heart with a yellow background there, is the core. It's like the core of a chip, you know. This is, we are calling it as e-Pragati core. And I will explain a little later about what is e-Pragati core. But around that, we have organized in this slide, where are we at this point of time. As a practitioner, it's my duty. I reported, I participated in this conference in Hyderabad. At that time, it was just taking its shape. Where are we today? How much of it is green, how much of it is in the red? So the symbolism here shows the green portion is all done and either operational already and getting aligned to the architectural principles. And what is in the light green there on the right side is in the making. The project is not getting built, developed. And what is in the violet there is about to be awarded. What is in yellow, blue and red there is probably where we have to really push it maximum. This is the bottom layer, we have to push it up this year. Then we are there. And even the core is something in the middle which is really integrating all these together in an open manner, in a loosely coupled manner. It's not a tight coupling, but a loose coupling defined by the standards and the architecture. That's how, you know, that's where we are. It's a report card, kind of simple report card. And this was also reviewed by our Honorable Chief Minister the other day, just 2 days before.
and the whole of government was present at the time. Then one more concept to complement this has been arrived at. We have been talking of Sunrise AP. Sunrise AP as a slogan, 2029. Number of indicators exist there, development indicators. So to capture that and build a bridge and make e-Pragati foundation for that development agenda, we found that, you know, they are going in different directions. That's no good. You have created a slogan that is going to be PROGAF and the e-Pragati is going to be foundation for a development agenda. So to make it really happen, what we created a framework now at this point is called Sunrise Scorecard. Meaning it will exactly measure on the development indicators, this PROGAF, this architecture will enable you to measure exactly where you are on healthcare front, your healthcare health goals, where you are in the educational literacy goals, where you are on maternal mortality or infant mortality, adult literacy, etc., child dropout, etc. Where are you? Where are you on controlling crime? Where are you on controlling corruption? Where are you on, you know, providing safe drinking water? These are all UN goals. But how do you measure them in a systematic, reliable, autonomous and automated manner? So that layer also we have built into this now. So it's going to be a very exciting period. It's no longer about IT, it is about development. You can see development, the clock ticking, you know, minute by minute. So let me, having spoken at the higher level, let me speak about these six competencies for a minute, minute and a half before I conclude. So that it gives you a flavor, a deeper idea about what I'm talking about. What are those blocks, each block there? I will talk about, there are about 30 plus blocks on the screen. But I will speak about six blocks, especially the core block there in the middle, which is of interest to not only government, but ultimately, my ambition is that it should be useful for any enterprise. The way it is architected is that it is useful to any enterprise, even in the private sector. It's like a core platform which anyone can use. We are developing that way. So I'll talk about that, and I'll talk about, you know, the farmers sector, a farm sector, education sector, and a people hub, which is based on Aadhaar, like Gaurav was mentioning earlier, the importance of Aadhaar that this country has. So I'll talk about these six pieces for a minute and a half so that we get a flavor of what we're doing there. And how, I mean, why it is taking so much time to do the whole thing. So let me talk about e-Pragati Core. That single block there is blown up into this bigger block here. The core part which I had shown earlier is actually blown up into this, that it has several components. Identity and access management, which every one of those 15 government organizations needs an IAM. Right? All these are needed by all the departments. It has no flavor of any, or it is agnostic to the department or agency that is using them. Even in, whether within the government or outside, it's all the same. So there is an IAM chipset there. There is a portal which articulates and which ventilates, which sends out all the 745 services through this portal. A single point of reference for all those 700 odd services. Organized according to life event, organized according to the departments, grouped according to various events, etc. Or the type of stakeholder. It is sliced and diced in different manners on a single screen. So you can click, within three clicks you can reach any service. With three clicks you can reach any service. You don't know anything to begin with, except that you have certain need to admit your child somewhere. That's enough. Within three clicks you should be able to accept your service. Right? That is the aim of the portal there, e-Pragati portal. And these are the days of apps rather than applications today. So there's an app store that is created. One exciting thing about this app store is not merely a group of apps that is put in a folder and you can download and you can use any one of them. That's good, but not good enough. What we said here
is to create a window for entrepreneurs, startups, etc. in this yellow thing on the App Store there, where we are publishing all the APIs of the rest of the e-Pragati packages, healthcare, education, rural development, urban development. Everybody is duty bound to publish their APIs, open APIs, except which is classified, you know, for obvious reasons, for valid reasons, they can't publish, you know, except that the default is that they should publish it on the App Store developer platform. So the developers can take it up and then develop apps of greater use, which is any number, any type, you know, more convenient. So it's an open window for innovation around governance and helping citizens, helping farmers, helping women, helping physically challenged persons and so on. So this is the window of opportunity we are providing so that they help the government, they help the citizens in the process. That's App Store. Then there is a payment interface, there is a messaging interface, there is a middleware ESB architecture. So all this constitutes the, and also a CLGS, which is a certificateless governance. All legal documents are reposited here so that no one should take any certificate, you know. The simple question is, what is a certificate? A certificate is something that, a document about something which the government already knows, it has already got. But it asks the citizen, right, to produce in the form of a certificate what the government already has. It's a very ironical, you know, situation that government in Department A has that information and Department B asks a certificate about this information. Why can't A and B talk to each other and save the burden on the citizens and abolish their certificate? So that is the theme of certificateless governance, which is made possible because entire government is one, right? Behind, under the hood, the government is one because of the enterprise architecture principles we are following commonly throughout. It's not possible if you compartmentalize, if you do project by project, it's not possible unless you have the enterprise. So under the hood, there is a lot of integration happening, you know, in the government. So CLGS is a classic example where we are able to transform and, you know, relieve the citizens to a great extent. There's a lot of corruption around such a well, no, that. How can you eliminate one stroke, right? So this is about the core. And one more good thing has happened. After this, we had an industry workshop. Number of suggestions have come. How will you enhance this architecture? We are not the repositories of the entire knowledge. So we had a 40 representatives from industry who came and talked to us. Then this is further enhanced, where we are putting a layer of, you know, openness, open APIs, etc. is being further enhanced. Microservices, how do you exploit? See, MSA, Steve talked about it in his presentation, microservices architecture. How do you take advantage of those latest technologies and not get saddled with, you know, older technologies? So all that is going to be transforming or changing this slide further into the next higher level after the consultation. So then second aspect is the people hub, which is fundamentally based on Aadhaar. The entire information about a family, a household, while Aadhaar is about an individual, each individual has a distinct Aadhaar identified by the uniquely by the biometric and the Aadhaar number. Likewise, each household is going to be identified in the people hub through a unique household ID. Because number of benefits and programs of the government are formulated around a family, around a household. So you should be able to uniquely identify and get all the advantages out of that. So people hub is designed. And we have created, this is one of the projects is already implemented and about to be launched. So people hub is a 4.234 crores, means 43.4 million records have been created through a survey done in the last few months. And this is going to be the platform for delivering all the development programs and services to the citizens. So that is very much another way. This is the kind of architecture of the people have. I don't want to go into details. That is a single source of truth on people and families. Next one is about land. Just as you know, you have Aadhaar today for every individual, probably most of the individuals in this room, except those who are, of course, our honored guests from other countries, they have Aadhaar number today. And it's my privilege to be the chairman at this point of time of the whole organization. So it made us think, you know, when individuals can have unique identification, why can't companies have unique identification? So that whatever individuals, whatever benefits you are getting from Aadhaar, you can get from what we are calling Bhoda. Bho means land in Sanskrit. Just like Aadhaar, Bhoda means serial number of a land, parcel of land. So it chimes well with Aadhaar, so we have suggested that name. That is the land hub concept. Our DC Mishraji is there, is a doyen in this field, and will be definitely, and they are implementing this concept. His organization is implementing the concept, and we are going to draw upon his team. So we have also team members, Gayatri, who is fortunately present here. She is the team leader also in that project. So it is about, you know, integrating and getting integrated 360 degree view of a piece of land, you know. What is its size? What is its description? What is there any litigation on this land? What is the history of transaction that happened on this parcel of land? Is there a property built on that? What is the tax, property tax on that land, etc. So the basic characteristics of that piece of property is all captured in one, you know, one single golden record. So that is the land hub that we are having. And today in this country, the amount of suffering that people undergo, families undergo on account of improper records about land is mind-boggling. There is a report which is almost a decade old, which says that 1.38 or so percent of GDP is eroded by bad titles that, you know, exist in this country. About land litigation, the uncertainty about land, a loan which could have been given in one day, takes 6 months, 1 year to give. Mortgaging that land. So development is halted to that extent. So it's cumulative between 1.8% of GDP. How do you improve that? What can be done? This is one possible answer to that. So this is just as I mentioned earlier, that just as Aadhaar is the unique ID for an individual, this Bhoda is going to be unique ID for the land. And there's a demographic and there's a biometric information for a person, fingerprints and iris. Here we have the geo-coordinates, the lat, long and azimuth of that particular piece of land. Even if it is aerially, you know, at a higher altitude also, it doesn't matter. We capture that uniquely and then preserve it as a fingerprint of the land parcel. It's the equivalent of a fingerprint. So that, you know, uniquely you are able to, you can't cheat, you can't sell the land twice to two different people. And title is very clear without confusion. So all those advantages will come with this architecture that we are doing. And then it is, yeah, as I said, you know, unique IDs like Aadhaar number, the extent of ownership, other details are like demographic information. And the map and geo coordinates are like biometric information, in comparison with Aadhaar, you know. Then this is about farmers, the third, fourth one is about farmers. This is how one small box there in the earlier is blown up into a bigger box, bigger chart here, which shows how, you know, each sector, like the farm sector, is farmer centric. It is designed in a way, in a modular fashion, where 74 services, some of them can be microservices with today's thinking, and then integrated so very easily across the whole of government. So, through a gateway. Then, so this is, you know, the entire primary sector, farm sector, whether you are an agriculture farmer, you are a horticulture farmer, sericulture farmer, dairy farmer, fisheries farmer, or you are, a poultry owner, etc. Doesn't matter. The logic is the same. The goal is the same, right? And the kind of benefits that are given by the government are about the same. The procedure for that is the same. So why do you have to compartmentalize them? Why don't you you know, create a common denominator for entire farm sector and drive around the farm department, not about the around the agriculture department, horticulture department, 20 departments. So farmer is the center of things here. That's how we have designed the whole thing. And similarly for the student, you know, from KU to PG and beyond, and into employment, skill development, it's all in one sector. You draw the big picture for this sector and create one platform, the whole of education. Okay? So that's how 24 modules and 41 services. So they accumulate, when you add up, it comes to 700 odd services, you know, different sectors. As I said, under the hood, there is a commonality across all this. And that is also revealed in the top layer. The top layer is the common application which entire government can use. Layer 2, you see, is the e-Pragati portal which orchestrates and which choreographs all these services before they are delivered to the citizen or stakeholder. And layer 3 is the common modules within that sector. And layer 4 at the bottom is unique to a particular agency. So that's how you can, the principle of reuse has been optimally deployed in this architecture. In every sector, the same 4-tier classification. What is common across the whole of government, put it on top. Build it once, use it 20 different times. Layer 2, components which are common across the government and useful in delivery, put them in layer 2, orchestrate, choreograph. Layer 3, common across farm sector, common across education sector, common across rural development and so on. And layer 4 is specific to, whatever is left is only specific to that sector. That's how 4-layered architecture has been designed, our entire documentation is around this, in these lines. I hope it gives you a clear idea. Then we also, one more thing we have done is the fiber net, which is 13 million homes we are reaching. We have reached already, the fiber has reached, fiber has been lighted already. Now we are in the process of giving the set-top boxes to initially to 1 million households and later scalable to 13 million. So the fiber, the entire thing has been done in 12 months time. It's a very unique project of its type where we are taking gigabit to the village, right? Gigabit, you know, connectivity several enterprises don't have even as of today. We are taking gigabit to every village in this Andhra Pradesh. We have taken that. It's only a question of getting started to, you know, CPE is the only issue now. You know, the set-up box. With that, the existing TVs will be transformed to provide internet. And it's a triple play. It's internet, voice, and also TV. All the 150 TV channels, 15 Mbps of bandwidth per month, 15 Mbps bandwidth, and two telephone numbers, landlines within a CUG of those 1.3 million. All this at 149 rupees per month. We have given already, which is $2.50 per month. You get internet, you get TV channels, 150 plus regular commercial channels, and two telephone numbers. Landline at 149 rupees per month. So entire revenue model is working that way. So this is one more achievement in this. And I mentioned about SDGs, etc., that building a bridge between development and IT. You know, enterprise architecture is about aligning IT along with business goals, business visions, business outcomes. So these are the outcomes expected. We are calling them e-Pragati indicators. We know KPI, right? Performance indicator conventionally, but we called it as EPI, e-Pragati performance indicator or e-Pragati indicator. So in each sector, we have identified what are the top things that should burn people's energy on priority compared to lesser, you know, things of lesser importance. What is the top agenda for the department, for the sector, for the farm sector, for instance? You know, what is the gross agriculture production? What is your productivity compared to China, compared to, you know, countries like Philippines, etc., in the paddy? How do you fare? Where are you? Where is your country? Where is your state? Is all
possible through this in a dashboard, right? Which I call, you know, sunrise scorecard. All this is boiled into one single number. All these 70 odd parameters across the whole of government, again weighted average, weighted total comes to out of 100 marks, how many marks have I secured so far? One single number which tells the performance of the government. Where are you vis-a-vis development? Automatically it will tell in the dashboard. If time permits, if you are connected on the internet, 1 minute I will show. Madam, Ethel, please. Is it connected on the internet? This system there? You can probably tell later. Otherwise, you can see today how we are doing it, where are we in this journey of displaying the whole of government's performance in one single, you know, screen. Right, like Ethar, our friend Sethi is here and his team is here from NIC. Ethar is a well-known portal. Gaurav and I worked together at that time on that. And it's a great, visible index of what's happening in e-governance across the country. So like that, we are going to build, e-Pragati is going to be there. And what are the lessons learned last 5 minutes? Is what is required? Can every government do and succeed in e-governance? What is required essentially? What are the key things before you can start? I'm not saying that, you know, it's a preserve of only a few governments, a few states, a few agencies. But from my experience, I put this, there's no kind of, I can't prove them through a mathematical equation or whatever. But from my 2 years of experience in deploying EA, Enterprise Architecture, I'm telling these are essential. The minimum cutoff mark and the maximum desirable thing I have given, political will is A. If a normal political will for a program is X, Enterprise Architecture needs 10x of political energy and time and force and, you know, all that is required from the top political leadership. 10x is the, I'm not exaggerating, unless 10x of force is applied, the engine won't move, the vehicle won't move. You need 10x to move this enterprise architecture. And likewise, you know, business vision should be very clear. You should have a business vision document first, then enterprise architecture document later, which I illustrated earlier. We have a very solid vision document in AP and several states also, so that's a requirement. An executive team, a technical team, financial resources, you can't get it for nothing, right? Yeah. So, evolution of e-governance. You can't, day one you can't think of enterprise architecture. If you have done nothing in e-governance, on day one you can't, there's no way you can sell this idea. It doesn't make sense. So you should have crossed a threshold and then only it makes sense. And then of course connectivity is very much required. Then how do you sell? Of course that Taj Mahal diagram is very important, but under the hood you should have some other reasons for selling this. One is how much money will be saved to the exchequer. How can your programs, your schemes become more cost effective and deliver more with less budget? How can you save on IT itself? The first one is about programs in various domains. Second one is how much you can save by consolidation. How much can you save? Third, how do you get quick wins? How do you show that, you know, that kind of an attractive honeypots to the political executive and then realize them? Then game changers, what are the various, like certificate-less governance, is it going to be a game changer? If you abolish certificates, you are taking the burden off the citizens. So it's a game changer. So 20-30 game changers across the whole of government will really propel people to work on this agenda. Otherwise, you know, why should they work? There is nothing attractive. You know, it doesn't make an appeal to them. Yeah. Next, please. Yeah. Then similarly, revenue from the service, you can charge 10 rupees, 20 rupees from service, becomes, several of these initiatives become self-reliant. Then boost to local IT industry and popularity of the government will improve once you have done your act well. Then positive externalities for India. When I think Gaurav is here and my appeal to him will be the following, this and the other slide, previous slide. Aadhaar 1.11 billion is already there. which is an asset for the whole country, which gives you, you know, a propulsion forward. Identity is no longer a paradigm for the IT guys. It's taken off your chest. It's not a problem. Drive for cashless economy is again one more push I am getting it. Digital India, the whole slogan, the initiatives under the banner of Digital India, this is all positive for us. Then mobile phone population, lot of services you deliver through mobile phones, and a good manpower which is IT ready, but it has to be enterprise architecture ready. So that kind of a graduation has to happen yet, but it's you are not starting from scratch. You have people who understand, who can understand possibly all this. So these are the assets for us. And then for India, my feeling is, it's not a critique about enterprise architecture, but having lived through it for 2 years, I'm telling, we should have some EA light, what is called, like a Diet Coke or something. We should invent a diet enterprise architecture. So it is shredding all its fat. It's very thin and slim and nice and good and attractive for people to understand and implement it quickly. Second is agile development method. If I stop, I'm sorry, James, ADM today is a classical way of doing things, but do people have time to go through so many iterations and so many cycles? You should be more agile. You take a lesson from that, you customize it to your own needs so that it's agile and quick to, like agile development methodology, agile architecture development methodology also should be agile enough. So that it is not fixed in time, it's continuously improved. You start with something, continuously improve it, learn and improve. EA as a service, can we do that? We're talking of today, PAAS, SAAS, everything, IAAS and IPAS, integration platform as a service. So many things are coming. Can we add to the jargon by calling EA as a service? Then that is really, it takes away so many concerns and learnings that every agency will have to go through. I just buy the service, customize it and start using it. EA as a service can together as an organization think about it. And Government of India can think about it. In fact, I'm chairman of the working group. There was a question from someone in the audience that we have had 5 meetings so far, and maybe 2 to 3 more meetings by March will be done with our recommendations. Really, it's coming off so very well. We are positioning it as the India core platform. India core, though my title of my talk today is in the agenda, you will see as India, INDEA, India Enterprise Architecture. So we should be really showing the lead to the whole world. That is, working group is really working with that spirit. INDEA, not IA, India Enterprise Architecture. I didn't put it formally in the slide because I am chairman of that committee and chairman of other things. I should not commit till it is formally approved. So, though the organizers have put it there, right? But we are working on that at this point. And sometime to respond to your question, sir, by April, our report should be out there. Then hybrid cloud. So these are the areas I thought we should explore. And this is the stack that is recommended for that EA, globally in other countries also they can see. There are commonality. If you put this as a service, all this you bundle, the complexity, it is all under the hood. You get the service, enterprise class service in these areas together at one stroke. That is what we should, EA as a service is my message. It's challenging, but doable, and should be done. I think we will be definitely, supporting any effort in that direction. And I would appeal to Steve and his team to just give a consideration to this concept of EA as a service. Is it doable? Thank you.